Hi, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Timothy Nicholls, and I'm Count Yogi's last surviving apprentice. I'm here today to give you a free lesson by adding a little bit of Yogi to your traditional hinge and lever golf swing, which will have fantastic results for you. Now, it's going to be different. There'll be some changes, but if you embrace the changes, and they're very simple, you're going to have the best golf shots and so much more fun than you could ever imagine. Now, am I saying that Yogi's way is the only way to play? Absolutely not. But if you're still above ground in a flesh body, it is the best way. Like the late great singer, entertainer, actor Dean Martin once said, you can get along in golf without Yogi, but not as well. So anyway, let's get started. Whenever I start teaching somebody that's just starting to learn Yogi, I always start with the basics first. Nothing in life is going to have any value, or you're never going to be able to build on something if you don't master the basics, which is a foundation. So we're going to start from the ground up. Now, a lot of people start with the grip, but no, we want to start from the ground up, literally where your body first touches the earth. Now, you've all been told to have your stance. I'll lay this down here. You're all been told to have your stance square. This is not right. Because what it does is when your body and the inertia load wants to go to the target, this weight is resisting. It doesn't want you to flow. This is why there's so many back trouble. And if you're duck footed with the right foot out, it's even worse. So what you want to do is you want to keep that foot straight. But if you're right handed, turn the left foot out, toes out to about 10 o'clock, 2 o'clock if you're left handed. But right handed, left foot out, turned at 10 o'clock. Now, what is the right distance? Well, the right distance is, if you see the Yogi finish, which most people use today, even the pros, if your back right knee is behind the front left knee with the leg straight, you're too wide. You can do that, go back and see it's too wide. If this knee is past this front knee, straight leg, and you go back, that's too narrow. So the simplest way is to stand tall, tip of the right toe, not sloppy or on the ball of the foot, but tip of the toe, knees equal, take a snapshot. That's the perfect distance and stance for your body, not anyone else's. Now we've established the footwork and the stance. Now we're going to go into the lower body, the leg and knee action. You don't want bent knees. I know they teach that. They say it's the athletic position, you know. Well, that's great if an object or a subject person is coming at you. Like if I'm a wrestler or a football lineman or a baseball player or a tennis player, the ball is coming at me. But in golf, it's stationary. That's why Iron Byron doesn't have bent legs and he doesn't shift his weight right and left. He's got a steady, consistent fulcrum and centrifuge in one place. That's why he's reliable to test balls. Now, we're not Iron Byron, we're made of flesh and blood, but we can do certain movements with our body to assimilate Iron Byron, where the centrifuge, which is people are using in their wrist and their fulcrum, are not so separated, where they can become more harmonized. So the proper leg action would be, you know the stance already, right leg straight, the front right side of the left kneecap bends at the ball. That would make your hips turn, swivel this way. That's the proper leg action. In one of Count Yogi, in fact, all of his books, but one for sure on book 3, page 22, Yogi shows you that exercise and how to do it. If any of you out there have that book, 5 Simple Steps to Perfect Golf, on page 22, when you do what Yogi's showing you, the exercise, stand taller than he is. That'll give you a more accurate feel in real time, a better feedback to your brain. And it'll be more simulated accurate when you're actually swinging the club. So that's the proper leg action. Okay, so we've established the correct stance and footwork, the lower body action with a straight right leg. Now let's get into what is the hinge and lever. Now it's called hinge and lever because you did have your feet square, you did have your knees bent, your hands low, and you've got shaft lean. So you've got this angle besides that angle. Now think about that. You've got to take it back, pronating the face offline. Make sure that this is stable and doesn't get too close or too far. Keep your head down. Keep the right elbow in. That's for the crying towel for later. Come back. Make sure you hold these angles just right and get the face square. Very difficult to do. Athletically, not that good. Not very intelligent. But if you have enough skill and judgment by pounding balls and playing a lot of golf, you can develop skill. Yogi used to call it the panda bear that walks the tightrope in the circus syndrome. It's not natural for that bear to walk that tightrope, but he has so much skill and judgment, he can do it. He makes it look easy, but it doesn't mean it's the easiest and best way for you. So what makes this so effective, now that you have the right stance and legwork, is the beauty of extension. I mentioned baseball earlier, you know, the tennis, you know, you have the straight right arm. You want an appendage. You want the arm to become part of the shaft. So the top of the handle isn't there anymore. It's actually up here, even if you have a little shaft lean. So the curse in golf is the shaft lean and these angles, that angle and that angle. So when you get rid of, these angles, now it's a lot easier to keep your head up, not down, because we're like horses, you know, the body follows the head. So we want to stay away from the earth at all times. So you start off tall, and when you smooth it away, you get to an appendage first with less shaft lean. I always teach no shaft lean, but there's always going to be some. But if you actually teach shaft lean, you're always going to have too much. Too much is no good, but a little bit is great. And none is fantastic, but if you have a little, that's good. So you stand tall, and it's a lot easier to pick the ball clean off the ground when you only have to move a quarter inch and to control the face because it's already straight without all this angle. So what do you do to get rid of that? Stand up. Stand up. So if I'm like this and I go like that and I raise my torso, look at that. There's a little bit of very little shaft lean, and this angle is very little. Now, when you do this to keep the club sold flat on the ground, you might have to move in a little bit. Now, if you're on the balls of your feet, you're too far still. If you feel like you're rocked back on your heels with the club sold, you're too close. So just start over with your correct stance. Now you've eliminated all these problems. And so when you take the club away, you smooth it away. Don't let it flop. Everybody parallels the shaft thinking that, oh, I'm going to hit it farther. I went back farther. You actually made your arc smaller. You're better to keep it out in space away from you and not as far back because, look, that is a smaller arc than that. And that's what you want. That's how you play older, younger. So for all you guys out there that were scratch or four handicap, now you're creeping up to an eight. You've lost 30, 40 yards on the drive. You can get it back if you do these principles that I'm sharing with you today, because the arc and the dynamics of this science does all the work for you. It's effortless power. So it doesn't rely on you being so strong. So the key is when you do take your club back, don't collapse the arms and don't overcock the wrists. Mentally stop your club head. It doesn't have to go far back. It just has to be out, away from your body. Come back and you'll be beautiful, perfect shots. Beautiful, perfect shots. And you'll notice that the ball will be high, but instead of dropping out of the sky because of too much backspin, coming up short of the green, you'll be on the green on the pin. Now, when you get to the top of your backswing, you're going to feel some tensions and pulls. I call it disciplines because it is soft yoga, meaning when you take it back inside, this should always come under the chin, not in front of it. And the tall stance won't let you take it to inside. You can't be flat when you're tall in the correct stance. So take it inside. So when you take it inside, you don't let the club head come closer by collapsing your arms, not being disciplined, or overcocking the wrists, not being disciplined. But hit that set point. Then you come back to be totally sloppy loose as you can be, staying tall, balls in the way, all the way around tip of the right toe. So there's only three things that can go wrong. You don't start off tall enough, and you don't stay tall. You collapse the club head and take it back too far, or you tighten on the way back. So you could be tight and collapsing, stay tall and relax. Don't flop, have a set point. That's all there is to it. And you'll have the most fantastic shots and the most fun. Now, for all of you